But in essence, Mr. Barroso was right. The European Union has the characteristics of an empire, but its nature differs from major global powers which we have known in the past, like the Roman or the British empires. And there are three differences. First of all, unlike Rome, the European Union enlarges by negotiation and consent. The second difference is that the European Union is an empire without an emperor. There are so many presidents in Brussels that in fact there is no real sheriff in town. And the third difference between Brussels and Rome is that Rome dictated Roman law to the subjects of its empire. The British imposed a governmental, administrative and judicial system which is still in place in most of its former colonies. The European Union administers its empire by distant rule. It produces rules and directives which have to be transformed into national law by national legislators. Only regulations and decisions are directly applicable in the member states. And furthermore, the representatives of member states exert strongly felt influence on the legislative machinery in Brussels. So there is neither a dictate nor an imposition. So Mr. Barroso should not feel ashamed for his words. He was perfectly right, in fact. The European Union is not imperial, it has no emperor, and it is not even imperialistic. And yet, it is an empire. It is an empire of grand designs and good intentions, upheld by membranes through distant rule. But there is one systemic shortcoming to it. It is disconnected from average citizens. Now, what did the European Empire bring? It realized quite many things which we regard as an achievement today. For business, there is a single market. Citizens are allowed to travel across the continent without restrictions, and they book flights at affordable prices. Most of Europe lives in affluence, which it would not have attained without the European dimension Mr. Barroso invoked. If one assesses the achievements of the European Empire over a period of 50 years, I will gladly conclude that the balance is positive. In today's world, a Europe without a European Union would be negligible, provincial, and marginal. But if you ask me if I'm happy about the European Union as it is now, I would frankly say no. Now, we have been living off capital for too long. Europe needs leadership, accountability, and political legitimacy among its citizens. There are too many chiefs and too few Indians in Brussels. And the decision-making process is a labyrinth in which even members lose their way. But most important, the European Empire still has one of the features which ultimately struck down most empires. It is disconnected from the people. Like submerged empires centuries ago, the EU is a world of political elites. European leaders happily appoint each other. It is for the sake of the people, but without the people. An empire may do well for some time, but elitist rule is not sustainable in the long run. In the European Empire, there is a permanent tension between vision and implementation. In Brussels, it is reflected in the relationship between the political and the administrative level, for example, between the commissioner and the members. By nature, a European member, like I was for some time, and like any member, wants to create order in a chaotic world. He wants to achieve stability, overview, and management. Everything has to be under control, and experiments are highly suspect actions of good intentions, which tend to end in failure. For the sake of stability, they are to be smothered at the infant stage. The opponent of the mandarin is the politician, whatever important post he may hold. The politician departs from vision, if not fairy tales. He wants change, publicity, votes. He tends to promise beyond expediency and will conjure up appealing horizons, and he will knowingly ignore detail. Most political careers are self-inflated on the public stage, on which the emergency exit is closely located to the hall of fame. You used the method of gradual integration based on technical files produced by European members and propelled forward by the political elites of the member states. It was government for the people, but without the people. The so-called method Bonaire expanded decision-making into most policy-making areas affecting daily life of citizens. Europe issued legislation, but hardly any citizen noticed. And this is a dream come true for every single member. The volatile, tricky, and stormy outside world is neutralized. Brussels works, and nobody knows. Now, for me, three criteria are essential. The first criteria to assess the text is, does the text reach out to citizens and connect European integration to popular support? I think this is the first criteria. The second one is, does the text streamline the institutional framework and prevent institutions from becoming top-heavy or anodyne? And thirdly, does the text clearly focus the mission of the EU in a limited number of policy areas in order to underpin economic prosperity in a global economy? Now, but to me, it is not a constitution anymore, neither in law nor in spirit. But what is it then? It is a revised treaty, but it has cherry-picked elements from the constitution. The current treaty revision indeed proposes new elements, but they are less revolutionary than, for example, the Maastricht Treaty of 1991, which laid the foundation for the euro and enlargement. Maastricht was the last really defining European treaty. Now let me look at the substance of these three main questions. The first one, does it reconnect to the people? It certainly takes away fear and anxiety about the nature of European integration, so no behemoth, no parallel entity. Instead of the United States of Europe, it remains the Europe of the United States. And this idea, I think, reconnects. But the text of the treaty does not. It is unreadable and inaccessible. Second question is about the streamlining of the institutional framework. It does to a certain extent streamline the institutional framework, but not yet sufficiently. Most European institutions have become top-heavy as a result of enlargement. They have simply grown with enlargement. And the final question is, does the treaty reconnect to its citizens? And I'm afraid it will not. Look at the reformed European Union from the public perception as it has been shaped by three main issues. First, Brussels bureaucracy. Secondly, the endless enlargement process. And thirdly, the estrangement from people. First of all, bureaucracy. So as I already said, the organizational streamlining remains too limited and too late. Secondly, endless enlargement. Over the past 5 years, the European Union has enlarged at a huge pace. 12 countries have joined, and that was right. I was in favor of that. Europe had to be reunited. But the EU has reached the limit of its absorption capacity. If it enlarges too fast and too far, it will collapse. Instead of importing instability by speedy enlargement, the EU should export stability by extending its concept of the internal market to regions like the Balkans, North Africa, countries of the Middle East, Eastern Europe, and Caucasus. And thirdly, the estrangement from the people. The current treaty continues some bad habits. The European Union is not underpinned with popular support and citizens are left in full. Only the European Empire and the Chinese Empire select a president by cooptation, but both are run by members. European institutions without democratic legitimacy are like empty boxes that will not be able to stand the test of stormy weather. They falter in the face of public anger over burning issues. I think, ladies and gentlemen, that the European Empire, Mr. Barroso referred to, can only survive as a valuable asset for the next generation if it is solidly underpinned by popular support. That is not populism, it is democracy. Thank you very much.